It's time to talk about violence against women. It may be psychological, physical, or even emotional, but whichever way you say it, violence against women is real. And the campaign against the elimination of all forms of violence against women reminds the world that this type of violence is one of the most widespread human rights abuses in all countries of the world. What is the situation in Nigeria? These and other questions and how to make Nigeria more women-friendly will be answered by the guests in the studio. I have with me on my immediate left the president of Women Arise, Joe Okay Odumake. Thank you so much for being here this morning.
Thank you, my pleasure.
And also the executive director, Project Alert on Violence Against Women, Josephine Efa Chukuma. Good to have you here this morning.
Happy to be here. Good morning.
So, let me start with you. Okay. What is the state of the Nigerian woman?
Well, the state of the Nigerian woman, if one should capture it, a 2012 report by UNFPA said one out of five Nigerian women has experience one form of violence or the other, be it physical or sexual or emotional. But globally, it said one out of three women. So if you calculate that, and again, in a situation whereby there's a lot in our climb, there's quite a lot of silence about it. Up to recently, just recently, people are beginning to talk about it, but still, there's still a lot of silence about it. The Nigerian woman is faced with violence not only in the public, violence in the home, violence in the workplace, cultural practices, religious misinterpretation and manipulation. Why do I say that? Because I don't believe religious books preaches violence against women, but it's the manipulation and misinterpretation of the religious books, the Quran, the Bible, you know, that are used to, you know, abuse the rights of women and young girls.
Okay, and Dr. Okay Odumake, violence against women, we have seen that most of the time it's even people that are very intimate, closer to the women that carry out this. What would you say is in the minds of such a person that decides that, okay, this woman, I'm going to do this? What is the mindset?
I really think that violence against women, like Josephine has said, is on the rise. But the perpetrators of these heinous acts, as rightly observed, has to do with those very close to the victims. Some even father who have a son, where fathers have forcefully slept with their daughters. Those people really trust. Then because of trusting such persons, there's just that mindset. People have that phobia around them, that is better for them to violate those who are very close to them, because there will be that siege mentality, and those people will not be able to speak out, and they feel that if they go outside and perpetrate the heinous act, it might be known. So maybe they live in the same house, the same environment, an uncle, an auntie, even a recent one that we had, an auntie who made a very young one that was kept in her custody to be going through that form of violence, of making her go through some process with her, experimenting some things with her. So we see that it's because of that trust, that sick mentality, that mindset, and the question of the fact that a lot of people are so ignorant of the fact that when this act is perpetrated, that they cannot continuously keep those people in silence. This will cannot be kept mute, you know, for a very long time. Apart from that, there's also, you know, like marriage is to complement each other. It's not to be seen as competition. Some men feel threatened when they have career women, when they think that the woman earns more than them. So the best thing to do to keep such a person under siege is to continue to perpetrate, you know, such heinous acts. So really, it's on the rise, on the increase, but people that are around them, like uncles, aunties, friends, and the rest, are those that perpetrate the heinous acts. And they have that mindset that it cannot easily be known. And the moment they see such a person, they will continue to keep such a person under siege, because day in, day out, probably is the person that will feed that person, is the person that will cloak the person. So they feel that perpetrating within their immediate environment will help to keep such acts under control.
Let me quickly pick you up on something you said. The first one being, would you say categorically that violence against women is based on gender, which means violence against women is consistently by men? Will that be the case?
I think that's the case. Violence against
100%.
Maybe that one of men, because let me just say that out of the 2,000 cases that we've documented, men and wives, only two men came to report that they've always been beaten by their wives.
Two men have reported,
and we invited the wife.
Woman, yeah.
And as soon as the man saw the wife coming, he ran under the table. But at the end, we were able to...
You're saying this happened in reality?
Yes, yes, our office. But very few, maybe like 2%. But what was the cost of the whole thing? The woman had three children. The husband is being paid 5,000 per month. When he's back from work, he'll be drunk. And they just tell the woman, jump on the bed. You know, the husband can rape the wife, jump on the bed. And at the end, the woman just felt that when such a thing happened, when she then realized that one day she had to beat the man, and after beating, he sobbed and slept off.
Perhaps so because he was drunk.
Yes, he was drunk, but that had to be a daily occurrence. So at the end, when we invited, we were able to empower the woman and give her some money. She started off business, and we kept, through counseling, the man was kept off alcohol. So if we have to weigh it, women go through about 98%, men 2%.
Have you seen any case? We've heard the saying that sometimes women are their own worst enemies. Mm. Let's talk about women, you know, carrying out violence against women.
Well, I don't buy into that refrain. For me, it's, it doesn't hold water. I don't believe women that we are our own worst enemies. I think it's just something that is used by society to create a divide between women. The whole issue of class and all that. I mean, it's another issue. The issue here that, yes, there are situations where women are the ones violating for the women, other women, especially when you look at it from the aspect of culture and tradition. There are a lot of cultural practices, you know. Well, I mean, from where I'm from, the Southeast, people will say, okay, the widowhood practices, who perpetrates is not women. But you see, the thing about knowledge, I tell people, we should learn to interrogate further. Keep asking why. Why do these women do it? It's cultural dictates. And I tell people, culture is not static. Culture is dynamic. Culture changes with time, with situations, with the environment. And a lot of these women, for example, that practice of widows being maltreated and widows, women in the community is taking the lead in that. Who pushes them also to rape? Sometimes, yes, it's mine, this is what is happening. I mean, widow has sort of become, it's core settling time. You know, your husband, your brother's wife, you want to sit back and this happens or that happens and all that. We need to understand violence against women in the context of power. It's a power relationship. It's about spheres of control. I'll give an example. If a man has a boss, a female boss in the office, and for one reason or the other, he didn't do his job well, he's found wanting his duties, and then the female boss says, come on, you didn't perform well here. You need to get back and go and get it right. I don't like the way you put this or you did that. Yes, ma'am, we'll go back. Would he slap the boss? Would he beat up the boss? He wouldn't, because once he does that, his job is on the line. But of course, he comes back home and he puts a cup or he picks his shoe and puts on the table by the dining, and the wife says, oh God, why are you putting this here? This shoe should be by the... That could end a slap for, say, why should you dare me? This is my house. So he sees that as his sphere of influence. He sees that as his territory, you know, and where he should exercise power and control. The same thing about sexual violence. It's about power, it's about domination. Dominating a woman physically, psychologically, sexually. You know, so we need to understand the power dynamics that comes into play. And we all know that Nigeria is a patriarchal society to a very large extent. We have a lot of young girls, for a lot of women, is from the will of the father to the will of the husband, or then the son, and then the husband. Where even some women are so thoroughly scared of their sons. They can't even speak to their grown-up sons. They can't speak to their grown-up sons. So we need to understand the dynamics, the power dynamics, when you're talking about violence against women, you know, or gender-based violence. It's used interchangeably. And also, like Joe said earlier, yes, gender violence makes it much more open. Using gender violence as against violence against women makes it, keeps that window open, that
that male gender, she was talking yes, about,
that the male gender could be a victim. But if we are to be serious about it and be honest with ourselves, we know that it's a female gender most times that is subjected and goes through this.
Okay.